Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Digital Integrated Circuits. I'm Professor Adam Teman of the EnICS Labs at Bar-Ilan University, and today we'll be going on to Lecture 9, which is all about memory peripherals. So let's give a quick overview of the peripherals of the memory. Well, last time we started with showing you what a memory structure looks like. And here we have the array, the memory array, which is the core of the memory. And it's made up of these bit cells. So each one of these guys is a bit cell or a storage cell. It's usually going to be, again, a 60 SRAM cell. But we'll see in a future lecture that there are other types of cells that you can make these out of as well. To access one of these bit cells, we need to go and crisscross both horizontally and vertically. So to get there horizontally, we use what we call a row decoder, or an X, sometimes called an X decoder. And the row decoder takes a number of bits, and out of the bits, it decodes the binary encoding of it and selects one row. The row that it selects is selecting words, because words are going to be organized along a row. And so we call this a word line, as you can see over here. At the y-axis, we need to then take out each word or each byte or each bit from the row that we read out. And so we drive these the content of them down to the bottom. And at the bottom, we have sense amplifiers that can come before or after the column decoder. But anyway, they sense what we have on the line. They turn it into a 1 or a 0. And then we have to remove the exact word or bits that we want. And that we do with a multiplexer. So this is a multiplexer that takes all of these columns and drives that, propagates out just the one that is selected. So this is a multiplexer, but usually it's made with a decoder. So sometimes we call this a Y decoder or a column decoder. So to get that, we want to define some letters that help us understand the sizings and so forth. Now, these are not standardized letters, but I feel that the using letters that have something to do with what they represent makes things a bit more comprehensible. So since we're talking about words, we'll use W for words. And when we talk about a memory, we ask how many words do we have in a memory. For example, in a 32-bit in a 32-bit computer, we'll usually have a word that's 32 bits or 4 bytes. Sometimes we'll just be discussing bytes. Usually computers address bytes, so each address refers to one byte, which is, of course, 8 bits. So if a word is C bits, and the reason I use C and not B is because a large B stands for byte and a small b for bit. So I use something else, and C stands for columns, because the bit lines and the bits are through columns. So if we have W words, and each word is C bits, for example, I don't know, 1024 words, each of them is 32 bits. So we will have a total of W times C bits in the entire memory. So each one of these SRAM cells, we have a total of W times C of them. To address them, what we need to do is select one of the lines here, okay? We need to select one of the words, and so therefore, if we take the log 2 of W, we will get the number of address bits we need, and we'll call that A. So we have A address bits that are coming into the memory, and we have to propagate those across the entire chip or wherever to get to the memory and say we want this word and not that word. Okay, but as we saw last time, it's very inefficient to put all the words in a one-dimensional array. So you're usually going to fold and put several words next to each other to get a more square ratio. So the number of words that we're going to have in one row is going to be 2 to the power of m, and m due to multiplexing factor. So m is the multiplexing factor, and that's actually the number of bits that are going to go into the column multiplexer to select one word out of the 2 to the m words that are in an entire row. Therefore, if we have a total of A address bits, but we need some of them to address the rows and the others to multiplex out the words, we're going to have, as we said, a multiplexing factor of m. So we have an m to a 2 to the m to 1 column decoder over here. That means we use m address bits in order to select which word we want. Therefore, we're left with A minus m address bits that go to select the row. So the number of rows is 2 to the power of A minus M. And since we have C bits in each row, so we do C times 2 to the power of M. That's the number of columns that we totally have. Again, 2 to the power of M words. Each one of the words is C bits wide. So we have 2 to the power of M times C columns. Our row decoder, therefore, is going to be an A minus M to 2 to the power of A minus M. So we have A minus M bits that go into the row decoder. Usually we use the MSBs, and they will select one line each. So there are 2 to the power of A minus M rows over here. And this is a one-hot type of a system. So we drive in the binary encoded address, or at least the MSBs of it, and it selects only one word line out of those. And the column decoder will take the bit lines that go down here, and we want to select one word, which is a combination, maybe 32 bits or 8 bits or something like that, of the columns. So we have a multiplexer over here, or our column decoder, that will take M bits, and it will choose one out of 2 to the power of M lines and move that to the end. So we will see that, how it's built and why we call it a column decoder, but actually it's a multiplexer. Okay, so now that we've seen the structure and we've given some names and sizes, we're going to go and just look quickly at what a synchronous SRAM interface is. So a typical on-chip synchronous SRAM features things like this. It usually has a single cycle read-write latency. In other words, we prepare the data, then we have the rising edge of the clock, and after that one cycle, we will have our SRAM do its job. That's either to read out the data after a propagation delay, or to successfully have written the data to the word that is selected. Then we have a byte write mask, which means that we are able to write a single byte out of the entire row that we select, or in the entire word that we select. And we'll have usually an active low write enable. That means that when we have write enable equals 1, we're actually doing a read. So usually what we'll have here is an address that is, some sort of M to 0 in the figure over here, in the schematic over here. The data that is written into the memory is going to be N minus 1 to 0, so N bits of data. The write enable, so we have write enable is going to be per byte, so that's P, which is going to be the number of bytes, minus 1 to 0, and each byte here, each write enable that becomes 0, that's a byte we're writing to. And again, if they're all ones, then we're going to be reading. Chip enable, that's going to select this block of SRAM versus other blocks of SRAM. So in order to read, what we need is a combination of chip enable being low and write enable being high. And if we want to write, chip enable being low and one of the write enable bits at least being low. Okay, we have a clock to make it synchronous, and Q is the output, which is going to be the same size as the data. So if we have 32-bit words, for example, then N equals 32 over here, and both the D and the Q will be 32 bits. Again, some companies will use a notation such as D and Q, as we call the flip-flop pins, because the SRAM is a type of a register. It's just a multi-bit register. It has a lot of bits. Sometimes they'll be called other things like data in and data out or so forth. Okay, so when we look at that, we have the timing diagram, and this is how the synchronous SRAM interface is usually working and defined. So what happens here is this is going to be the rising edge of the first clock that we're going to relate to. And previous to the rising edge setup time before, in fact, we have to prepare our address. Okay, so our address has to be ready over here. Over here, it's messy. Okay, and we have to prepare our data. So there's going to be a setup time relative to the address pin and the data pin. And in order to write, we're going to drive down the write enable, WE or WEN. And again, that has to be ready, some sort of setup time before the rising edge of the clock. The clock rises, and since the write enable here is low, that means we're going to write data 0 to address 0. And when is that going to happen? It's going to happen some sort of TPD after the clock. It's nothing that we can see outside, but there is some sort of a write access time that is going to have to be used before it has to be finished before the next clock rise, so our frequency is going to be set according to that. Then we can, some hold time after the clock, we can change the address and change the data. Okay, and because we kept right enable low, we're going to have another write on this rising edge of the clock. So address A1, data D1 is going to be written to address A1. On the next clock cycle, what we did is somewhere in between, we raised write enable, and therefore it's going to be a read and not a write on this cycle. We only provide an address. We float the data in. I mean, we don't provide a data in. Or even if we do provide something, it doesn't matter what it is. We provide address A2 over here, and on the rising edge of the clock, again, we have some sort of setup time before that this and this have to be prepared. We are going to have a rising edge of the clock and some sort of TPD after the rising edge of the clock. Data 2 is going to be stable, and that is our read access time. Again, we have to hold address 2 for some hold time, and since we kept write enable high over here on, and we prepared another address on our next clock cycle, again, we're going to get data 3 over there. Okay, so that is a synchronous SRAM interface. As you can see, the data for a read is ready at the next clock cycle. The data from a write is written right after the next clock cycle. And we can change our address immediately after that clock cycle. We don't have to hold our data, our address or our data any longer, except for the hold constraint of those pins. We can have what we call an asynchronous interface, which means that the minute our address changes for a read, we will get a TPD later. We will get our data on the read bus. Read data bus. Usually, writes are always going to be synchronous. So as we can see, the rising edge of the clock results in a write when the write enable is low. And the rising edge of the clock results in a read when write enable is high. So finally, saying that what we have here is a cycle, as we can see, that is it consists of once we have the rising edge of the clock on a read cycle, we're going to have some sort of read access time. That's some sort of a TPD, a propagation delay. Okay, and then we're going to have our data ready. Okay, a read cycle is, again, from the beginning of one read to the end of another read. Okay, and a write cycle is going to be from the minute we raise our write clock until our data is written. The total cycle time has to be at least larger than the read access time and the write access time, and including the setup and hold times of the of these data. So that's just a simple kind of a definition. When you look at actual definitions from a data sheet, and here I found something online that gave a piece of an old SRAM data sheet, you see that you have lots and lots, and there are actually plenty more than this, of these different types of times, like address setup time, address hold time, chip select setup time and hold time, output enable setup time and hold time, and so forth, and a total minimum clock cycle time. And they're all going to be defined in different waveforms. So here's the waveform of the write cycle, here's the waveform of the read cycle, and these get pretty tedious with lots of pages of data, and you have to be familiar with them when you go to an actual SRAM block that you buy from a vendor. However, they are basically the things that I showed you, just with a deeper level of detail. So the major peripheral circuits, therefore, in an SRAM are the row decoder, which we're going to be discussing in the next part of the lecture very in depth. Then the column multiplexer or column decoder, the y-axis that selects the bits that are going to be propagated out to the data out bus. Okay, the sense amplifiers, which are going to see the level that's stored in the SRAM to see if it's a 1 or a 0. The write drivers, which are going to drive a 1 or a 0 on the bit lines in order to write to the cell. And the pre-charge circuitry, which is going to charge the bit lines to VDD before a read operation. So that's what we're going to be discussing in this lecture. So I hope you enjoyed, and we'll see you in the next part of the lecture.